So, the most wonderful historical reality is Jesus coming into this world. And one of the things that we know in our hearts really is that he came because he loved us. And we're so thankful for that. And Lord, we've come into this place today because we love you. Thank you for first loving us and coming in a way that we don't even really understand all the way, because you existed before you came. You are God, but you became one of us, a perfect gift from heaven. Let us truly receive you as our King, as our Savior, as our Messiah. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
grateful. Hallelujah.
And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end. That's why we're here this morning.
Thank you, Amen. Jesus. 1, 2, 3, 4. Sing it together.
Alpha, there's no one. The angels did say, was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so dreary.
Is the King of Israel.
with us and rejoicing with us this morning.
Amen.
We're singing with the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill to all men. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Lord, for your mercies are new every morning.
Hallelujah. Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. That blood is ever flowing, folks.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord, for becoming the Lamb.
Bless your name, Lord Jesus. In the darkness, we were waiting without hope and without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died.
Let's praise him.
Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit.
Till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb has conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. Hallelujah. And the Church of Christ was born when the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not yield and shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
time for Jesus.
Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. Praise forever to the King of Kings.
We love you, Jesus. How we love you, Jesus. Father, we love you so much.
Yes, God.
We're so grateful. And Lord, even though none of us have it perfect, okay, none of us are without trials and tribulation. But you're here.
Yes,
Lord. Emmanuel, God is with us. No matter what shadow I walk through, if you've got Jesus, you're going to be all right. You're going to be all right. You're going to be better than all right, because he's going to use it to refine you and to just draw you closer so he can love up on you even more. God, we thank you so much that your blessings never end. Thank you, Father, that your heart is so big and so generous. You just always want to pour into us. Lord, I pray, God, that we would see you in that way. That we would see, Father, your Father's heart is not like some of the fathers we had. But that makes it even greater when we receive it. Father, thank you. Thank you that you meet all of our needs. It's not, you just want us to open up the door. Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. At your heart's door, and if anyone hears my voice, all you do is say, Jesus, I hear you. I know I need you. Open that door. He's not looking for perfection, because he knows that's impossible with us. But all things are possible with God. Holy Spirit, we thank you so much for your presence, for your power, God, and for your great love for us. Continue, God, in this service to be glorified. Lord, just pray blessings upon blessings upon blessings upon your people today, those that are listening, those that are here. Pour out, God, your blessings, your peace, your power, Lord. And may we fulfill your purpose on this earth and glorify Jesus in everything and in every way. Thank you that the blood is pouring out continually. You know? It's testifying continually. Will you receive it today? Will you just receive it today? We're all messed up. Every day I got to go receive it, right? Thank you, Jesus, that it's there forever. The sins of the whole world have been paid for. Thank you, Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit, we love you. You guys can sit down if you want.
Morning, everybody. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And today we celebrate when that Son came to this earth. And so we want to give an opportunity to move in that same nature that Father God has. And that is to give. There was a man named Simeon that when he was in the temple and baby Jesus was there, and he said, "This child is a light to the Gentiles." And everywhere that word in the Greek is used is also used as the word revelation. And so we are here this morning because we have a revelation of Jesus Christ. And so I would just ask you to pray and see what the Lord would have you give. Even in the world, they say it's better to give than to receive. There is something special about moving in that revelation of Jesus Christ, because that's what we're doing when we give. We are moving in the very nature of the Father, because he gave his only begotten Son. And so let's pray as the ushers come. Dear Heavenly Father, we just ask, Lord, that you would move upon our hearts, that you would speak to us what we should give, how we should move in your very nature. We thank you for giving your Son, Lord. We thank you for not holding back anything in regards to everything that we need. We thank you that you've given us all that pertain to life and godliness. And we now ask that we would move in that nature. In Jesus' name, amen. As they're taking the offering, we do have a quick announcement about New Year's. We are going to have service on New Year's Eve and New Year's Day. So please come and be with us. Amen.
Are you? Is it on? Is it on? Is it green? Merry Christmas. We got any other children in the house that? One of the things that I'll tell you what we'll do is at the end of the service, hey young man, here, there's a gift for you.
Thank you.
If you have grandkids or you need a special gift on the way home, if you need to help somebody, there's a few. The blue ones are for the boys, and the pink ones are for the girls. So I think you'll figure it out. It's such an honor. Yeah, you want one? Pink. Pink is yours. Don't be stepping on my snow. Pink. You don't want purple. You want purple? Okay, you got purple. Might not be. I know that we're in Florida, so you got to come up with some fake snowballs or something, because we're never going to see it here in Naples. But do you know you have to go to Fort Myers to the Hertz Arena, and you have to wait in line for 2 hours to see a mountain of ice for people to throw some stuff around. But one of the things that I want to share with you today is it's such an honor to, first of all, be with all of you. Thank you so much for just your giving heart, for being a part of this church. It's such an honor to serve and to be a part of this wonderful body of believers. I thank you so much for being here with us this morning. You could be in so many different places, but yet at the same time, I don't know of a better place to be than coming and honoring him, and especially on this Christmas day. And I know we have a lot of things going on, and there'll be things happening this afternoon and tonight, and stuff happened last night, and so, and then we have the next few days, and before we know it, it's a new year, it's a new beginning. But if you would stand with me, and I'm going to continue the series that we have, and I will continue this series next week as well, because there are some things that we need to grab a hold of in regards to this wonderful revelation, the Word became flesh. And we have this theme scripture, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld the only begotten, full of grace and truth. The wonderful thing for the first time, really, in such a unique way, is to behold Him, to see Him. And as Jay was sharing, the revelation, this child was revealed to us. Revealed. Now, He was born, but He was given. It's not that He didn't exist before. He literally was born into this world, but He existed before. Because that is what's important for us to know, that He's always been there for us. Before the foundations of the earth, before He even began anything, He is the one that was thinking of us and loving us before we were even created. Father, I thank You so much for the gift of Your birth, for the gift You gave to all mankind. Help us to receive You, to enjoy You, to realize the peace that You bring. Spirit of God, come upon us and allow this gift, this birth, to change us. Reveal Your truth to us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Turn to someone and say, I'll get you next time. With the snowballs. So I was thinking about this in a lot of different ways, but I remember when I'm a father of four. I've talked to my kids last night, talked to them this morning, and I was remembering, you know, specifically Jillian, my firstborn. And I remember the anticipation of her coming into this world and also the fears that I had. Anybody's a father, a mother here, that the fears, I wonder if they're going to be okay. I wonder if they're going to be healthy. I wonder what their life is going to be like. And then you just start trying to say, I don't know if I can do this. I don't know I have the capability of even accomplishing something like raising a child. And you think about all these things, but once the child is born, there is something that happens. It's almost like when you check out everything. You make sure, you know, I remember just being amazed at this wonderful gift that God had given. And yet at the same time, there was this trepidation, this concern about what do I do with this? I didn't know what to expect. I didn't know what color hair she was going to have. I didn't know any of those things. There's a scripture actually that says, it says, God, thank God for the gift too wonderful for words. Yes. You know, indescribable. Yes. And you're trying to describe something. And so if that's what happens in the natural, just think about what happens in the spiritual. When you combine Christ coming into this world, and then you combine the reality of who He is, it is indescribable. Yes. It's beyond comprehension to be able to even communicate this reality that the Word became flesh. And even if all, I mean, John says it at the end of his book, he says, if all the books in the world could not describe the reality of what we have, and the reality of who He is, and the glory that has been revealed to us, and it is unique. But I want us to also see from a perspective, and I know we've read the scripture so many times, but I want to go to Luke, and I want to just spend a little time there. In this first five verses of scripture, to me, is just the reality of life. And I just want to say to you, this is the reality of life. I mean, you read this, if you haven't paid any taxes, you're probably not old enough or something, but, you know, it says, it came to pass in those days that there was a decree, and everyone should be registered. The census first took place, and it says the governor, so we have all this, went to be registered, everyone to his own town. For what reason? To be taxed. And one of the things that I love about this portion of Scripture is you have people in this portion of Scripture that don't even care about God. They're just in it for themselves. They're trying to register. They're trying to make you a number. You ever feel like these days that all you are is a number? I mean, trying to call and they don't even want to know your name anymore. They just want to know your number. You know, give me the last four digits of your social security or something. You know, it's like you're, and you're a machine. This is just, these machines are driving me crazy. Just, you can't even, and then when you push 000 to want to talk to a representative, no, you pushed the wrong button. But it is kind of an interesting thing of how all this thing is set up. And we know he's from Nazareth. I mean, the sense of Joseph and Mary were in Nazareth, but that's not where they're supposed to be. They're supposed to be in Bethlehem. So in many ways, God can take wherever you are and bring you to the right place. You know, that Joseph and Mary lived in Nazareth. That's where they were engaged. That's what was going to. And then because of the lineage and who they belonged to, they were forced to go to Bethlehem. As David shared last night, he says, no one ever really talks about this, but that trip of a woman being 9 months pregnant, traveling about 35 to 70 miles, whatever length it was, I don't understand how he survived that trip as a man, you know, because that lady was quite a bit upset about coming to that. But it says in Judah, the city of David. So we have all of a sudden some indications of the prophetic revelations that have been spoken through the Old Testament to be registered. And the thing is, the world, all they want to do is make you a check mark. That's all they want. But God has a much bigger plan. And he will use whatever system. I mean, I don't care if you are in communist countries or if you're in a country where it's not doing well or you're over here. God can still and does miracles wherever his presence is. And even though we don't like some of the changes that are happening, God is still in charge of it all. So it's now this is the part that I want a little help. Can you say the word so? So this is the thing. All of these things are part of our reality. So I want us to kind of catch the so in here. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. She brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes. And I want us to understand this aspect of swaddling clothes. It's going to be mentioned a couple of times, and I want to make sure that we understand it. And laid in a manger. Now, we know all these things because there was no room for them in the inn. In a sense, this is also part of our struggle. Why aren't things working out the way I want to? Why are things not the way I desire? Why am I going through what I'm going through? What's going on with my life? It does not seem fair, doesn't seem right. There should be room in the inn. This should work out. And it seems like it's not working out the way that I perceive or the way that I think. And all of us experience this. We've experienced it with our children. We've experienced it at our job. We experience it almost on a daily basis. Things don't work out exactly the way we want. And actually, a lot of us get very, very frustrated with it instead of embracing it, because maybe there's a reason that I'm where I'm at right now. Maybe there's a reason that I am in the situation that I'm in right now. And God can use me in that environment, which I don't want to be in. I mean, think about through history, this has been so often proven. You know, Joseph didn't want to be in prison, but there he interpreted dreams for these two men. I mean, you look at through history, every time you turn, my grandfather was in concentration camp. He didn't want to be there. I've been in situations, you've been in situations where we didn't want to be. And yet God can use those situations to bring about his fullness. And this is one of the things that we see here, and it's very important. So it was. But now in verse 8 it says now. Everyone say now with me. Now. So if we can see the was and now, understand that God can use the was and make a now out of it. It says, now there was in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. I see some people up there that I haven't seen in a while. I'm looking up. I love you guys, Trina, John. Michael, you're and all of you up there. So one of the things that I want you to notice about this portion of Scripture is they were watching over their flock. It's an interesting thing that they were in the field watching over their flock, and I think in a minute you're going to understand a little bit more about this, but it says, so now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night, and behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Again, in these moments where we feel like, okay, I got a message from God, I hear something, but I don't know what to do with it, I don't know how to handle it. And then it says, then the angel said to them, do not be afraid. It was said last night, and I want to say it again to us today, the enemy would love for us to live our lives out in fear. But God has not given us a spirit of fear. So we have to look through the fear into faith of what God's trying to show us. And it says, for there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who's Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. I don't know if you've ever read this in that context, but one of the things I want to show you, to the shepherds, this was a sign. What are you talking about, angel? This was a sign. This was a very unique sign that they understood. Maybe we don't understand. You will find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. So again, we know that it happened. Mary wrapped him in swaddling clothes. But here it repeats it again very clearly. This will be a sign. So swaddling clothes is a sign. And you will find him in a manger. That's a sign for the shepherds. And one of the things that says, and suddenly there was with the angels a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God, saying, and of course this is our famous line that we, you know, as we've left it here separate, glory to God in the highest, on earth goodwill towards men. What it was being declared is this sign, this revelation, this coming is for the glory of God, and to the earth it's going to bring peace. I mean, Jay sings the song, there's always seems to be a war going on inside of us. I don't know if you've ever noticed that. There's a battle going on inside of us, and if we're not careful, one of the things is that we're fighting this battle instead of allowing the Prince of Peace to settle it once and for all. That he's got it. He's in charge. Because he wants to bring goodwill towards us. He wants us to know that his desire is to bless our lives. And so it goes on to say, so it was when the angels had gone away from it in heaven, the shepherds said to one another. So there was not just one shepherd, but there were multiple shepherds. And I did some study on this, and I want to kind of make you understand this principle a little bit, because often we don't even think about these things. Everything that God has done is for a purpose. Now, so if the registration was for a purpose, if the taxation was for a purpose, if him bringing them from Nazareth to Bethlehem has a purpose, then these shepherds have a purpose. You and I have a purpose. God's trying to reveal something. And in those areas, one of the things that you know, that they had a sacrificial system that was set up, that they would regularly offer up lambs at the temple for sacrifice. Now, how do you do that? Unless you have a system set up, and I don't know if you ever heard this phrase before, but there's Levitical shepherds. Levitical shepherds, their job literally was to raise up lambs for the purpose of sacrifice. That was their job. And one of the unique things is that this sign of swaddling clothes and laying in a manger is something that they were very, very familiar with. And so I want to show this to you as we read on a little bit more. It says, "And when they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph, the babe lying in a manger," because, well, how did they know where to go? They must have known, because mangers are not found in inns, especially the type that Christ was laid into. Swaddling clothes was not the norm in that sense. But it says, "Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told to them concerning the Christ," this Christ. "And all those who heard it were marveled at those things which were told to them by the shepherds." So the shepherds begin to say, the shepherds begin to declare. And so I want you to see something here. This is the swaddling clothes that usually is used in a sense, but it was something that I didn't really understand at first, but one of the things I can tell you is that these lambs had to be perfect. So these shepherds would take these lambs when they were born and they would try to protect them to make sure that they had no scars or any fault on them, because if they had any scars or faults on them, they could not be used as a sacrificial lamb. So they had to be perfect. And so one of the things that we see here is this cloth, and then we see the feeding trough. It was made out of stone. And it was kind of a unique place to understand that you had the swaddling, you had the stone. This is what they were using. And then this is a picture right out of that area, which was a little cave, a little area, and a little protective area. So the sheep that were born would not hurt themselves, that they would be protected. But there's also another interesting thing, and you'll find this in Malachi if you want to look at it. Malachi chapter 4, it talks about this. But they had these particular places where they would watch over the flock. And they had these towers that they could see over the area to protect. And they would notice when one was being ready to be born. And they would go out and they would bring him in and they would put him in a place where they would be protected. And they would wrap these swaddling clothes around the sheep to keep it from harming itself. So they knew the sign, and they also knew where these places were. And so this is where, in some ways, you see this, a place like this is where Jesus possibly could have been born. We know that he was born in a cave. He was not born in a stable in a sense, but the stable in a sense was a place where sheep were being taken care of. So you have this, and there's another one. This is another picture of one that, and these are actual pictures that exist, and these places are still there today. So what am I saying? But we speak the wisdom of God in mystery. There's so many mysteries that I love. Every time that I open up the Word of God, there's another mystery that God wants to show me. He wants to make sure that I understand that there's not one single thing that just happens by chance. God is constantly working with me. And so the crazy thing sometimes I feel like in my life is that I have messed up so bad, there's no way that God can make it right. That's what we say to ourselves. And then God gives us a little revelation, a little insight that he has been at work in our lives from the very beginning, before we were even born. He planned all these things out. But we speak the mystery of God and the mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages of our glory. In a sense, we are experiencing the glory of God because of his glory and because of his love. And the reason we can sustain ourselves in this crazy world that we live in is because we're holding on to that eternal truth that he has given us. And so you see it, which none of the rulers of this age knew. So these people who were registering, these people who were trying to take care of this, the people that we have in Congress today, in the Senate, they think they're doing their thing and they're doing some crazy stuff, But at the same time, they're not going to stop God's eternal plan. Amen. Maybe your boss at work is not really taking care of you the way you should be taken care of at Costco. You know, you don't know. You don't understand all the different things that are going on, and yet God is taking care of these things. For had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord. You know, one of the things that we know, they were trying to take him out at the beginning. They were trying to take him out at the end. It was always a battle. And you wonder sometimes to yourself, why is it so hard sometimes just to walk with God? Why is it not the easiest path? It's because we're going against the stream. We're going against the flow, and yet God uses that resistance to bring us revelation and clarity. So it goes on to say, eye has not seen nor ear heard, nor have entered into the hearts of men the things which God has prepared for those who love him. So one of the things that I want to say to us is that he loved us. That's the first truth that we know, for God so loved. But also, one of the things that happens to us when we love him, it says in Romans, it says, all things work together for good to them that love God. Now, to me, that's always been one of those interesting scriptures. It doesn't mean that everything that happened in my life or in your life or is happening in your life or in my life right now is good. But the one thing I've got to hold on to, the revelation I need to hold on to, is allowing his love to be the source of my understanding, not the other way around. I really, truly need to hold on to that. And he goes on to say this to us, for God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, deep things of God. For what man knows the things of man except the Spirit of man, which is in him. So there's something inside of you, which is called the Spirit of God, that draws you, that causes you to have that sense of awareness. And sometimes there's something fighting in you that doesn't want you to yield to it. And yet the Spirit of God is within you. And the Spirit of God wants to lead you into all truth. He will show you his way. Even people who are so far from God can still be used in a supernatural way to accomplish exactly what God wants. Now we have received not the spirit of the world. So there's this spirit of the world that we experience on a regular basis. Matter of fact, you'll experience it on the way home. Maybe somebody will, you know, blow their horn at you. Or last night on the way home, I was driving and I thought I had the right of way, and I pulled out and I don't have the right of way. And of course the guy just, and I'm going, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. There's always a little bit of a challenge going on with all of us, isn't there? That we have not received the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us. Do you know the gift, the Word becoming flesh, has freely been given to us? And that is beyond even my comprehension, because usually we have strings attached to our gifts. I mean, that's what Santa Claus says, right? If you've been naughty or nice, isn't that the battle that goes on? And you don't deserve this? How many times in our spirit the world wants to tell us we're not worthy, and yet God says you are? This is what's being revealed to us. And I want to just make sure that we understand this wonderful gift that God has for us. And I want to end up with Colossians. I shared a little bit from Colossians last week, and I want to end with this. But we also pray that you will be strengthened with all his glorious power, so you will have all the endurance and patience you need. I don't know what's ahead, but one thing I know, he's already got it in his hands. I don't know all the stuff that, I mean, who would have ever thought we would have gone through what we've gone through in 2022? All the different things. And for some, It was physical. For some, it was spiritual. For some, it was natural. If you did not experience a natural disaster this year, you were very fortunate, because a lot of people that we've dealt with, and even right now, out there, which doesn't look very pretty, is still stuff out on the road that needs to be gotten rid of. It's like the kids and everything. It seems like it's all been turned upside down. So it says to us here, endurance and patience you need. May you be filled with joy. Isn't that what Christmas is all about? Joy to the world. Joy that we may be filled, always thanking the Father. He has enabled you to share in the inheritance that belongs to his people. The reason he came is to give us an inheritance. He is the one who sits on the throne, and he is the true eternal king. So it says to us here, belongs to his people who live in the light. When Jesus Christ came, he was the light of the world. For he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear Son. I want you to notice how it says it. It says it so simple, but he rescued us from the kingdom of darkness. Kingdom. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And definitely he has destroyed the kingdom of darkness. He has conquered hell, death, and the grave. He has conquered even birth in the sense of coming into this world and revealing himself and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear Son, who's purchased our freedom and forgave us our sins. And I know that is something that is beyond my understanding, because someone constantly is saying to me, you still fall short. You still don't have it all together. You still lack. And God says, no, you don't. You're complete. You're healed. You're forgiven. And this is one of the things that we know in the Old Testament, in the dark age, in a sense, is you always had to cover, 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 cover. And in the new, it's been revealed that we are forgiven, forgiven, forgiven. And once and for all, our sins have been forgiven. Amen. So we wrap it up with this thought, and I think it's Christ is supreme. I know he's an infant here in the way that we see him during the season, but he is also the eternal one. Amen. So often one of our problems in our conception is this: oh, I've received Jesus Christ in my life, and I need to mature. The Holy Spirit in you is already mature. Jesus in you is already the perfect one. He's not waiting to be perfect. He always was and he always will be. And the Holy Spirit's not some kind of immature Holy Spirit inside of you. You received the perfect gift inside of you. It is beyond our understanding sometimes. It says, Christ is the visible image of the visible God. Existed before anything was created and supreme over all creation. For though in him God created everything in the heavenly realm and on earth, and he made things which were seen and the things which were not seen. See, this is one of the things that we can tell you right now, is that for the first time, when Jesus Christ was born, we saw the visible reality of who he is physically. We saw him. But he always existed. He always was and always will be. And one of the things we see here, he made things that can see and the things which cannot see, such as thrones and kingdoms and rulers and authorities. And that's why I was saying earlier about how it didn't matter if this Caesar was in charge or this president's in charge or this governor in Florida's in charge or whatever you want to say. None of those things really truly matter, because he is in charge. Amen. He is the ruler. The supreme gift of God, authorities, the unseen world, everything was created through him and for him. I want you to think about this with me. Everything was created through him and for him. And yeah, we've talked about the gift of who he is, but do you know the gift that you are? You were created. What does it say? Through him. And you were created for him. And he made a way where there was no way. I mean, Mary said it. It says, how can this be possible? I've never been with a man. See, God does something that's impossible by the Holy Spirit. The angel said, it says, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. That's what has been said in this message today. And it will not return void. It will accomplish that which he desires. He makes the rain fall down. He waters the earth. He does the things that need to be done. And even today, he is pouring into you his love, his grace. It says right here again, everything. Why don't we just say, Andrew was created through him and for him. What about your name? Come on, put it, say it, say it. Just go up there and say, put your name on there and just say it. I can't hear you. Yes, he did that for us. He did that for us. And this simple revelation of just the Levitical shepherds, they knew what it meant. And they knew who he was. And they shared that wherever they went. And I'm going to tell you something. Every time I turn around, I get another little glimpse of what he has done. And I want to share it with you. And I want us to share it with others. Would you bow your head? I've been friends with many of you for many years. And Elias sitting up there, I've known Elias for 30 years. I've known this guy over here for 61 years. Many of you in this place I've known for years, and some of you I'm just getting to know. But one of the things that is so wonderful, he's always known you, and he's always loved you. And there seems to always be some kind of conflict going on in your life. You've heard this story before, but it just, you know, Mary, my mother, had a little Lambert, and his hair was white as snow. But my mom literally was dying when she conceived me, and that was his fault. And she was literally dying, and they had to take her to the doctors, and there was no way, the doctor said, there was any hope. And they said, you need to abort this child. Can you imagine this idea of sometimes you feel like there's no reason you should be here? The devil wants to take you out before you're even born. We know the story about what even happened when Jesus was born. How Herod heard about it and he was furious. And there was a cry in Bethlehem of all these children that died because he came in trying to protect his lineage, trying to protect who he was as a king, and he couldn't do it because Jesus escaped to Egypt to fulfill another prophecy because the children of Israel were in Egypt, so he came out of Egypt back into Israel. This is important stuff. And even regardless of what you've gone through, the devil says, no, you don't deserve to live. And God says, no, I'm going to make a way for you to live. He has every intention of killing you. But God says, I have come to give you life and that more abundantly. And if there's anyone here, just keep your eyes closed for a moment. If there's anyone here today that you have not surrendered your life to the Lord, he's known about you all along. And it's not by chance that you've come on this Christmas day to this service. God wants you to know that he created you. And for his glory, you were created to enjoy life forevermore. If you want to accept Christ, just raise your hand. I'm looking all around. I see that hand. I see that hand. We're here. Let's stand together. Maybe you've never thought about it from this perspective, but if the ministering elders would come and just stand here, and as we wrap things up, I want you to think about this for a second. Maybe you feel like you're like in Nazareth and nothing's working out. And matter of fact, actually, this is what it said. One of the disciples said, is there anything good that can come out of Nazareth? You know, Jesus wasn't from Nazareth. He was from Bethlehem, but he moved back to Nazareth to prove a point. We call him Jesus Nazarite. There's the Nazarene church. I don't know if you ever heard of that, but that is a Nazarite vow that was made. But one of the things that I want to tell you is you have a relationship with Jesus, but you're on a journey to Bethlehem. And I'm going to just simply say this. You're on a journey to Bethlehem. What Bethlehem means, house of bread. The Word became flesh. God wants you every day to take a little bit more of a bite of the bread of life. He wants you to feed on Him, to receive Him, to have revelation, to have insight. And what better day to say, I want to move closer and closer to the Lord. I want to identify with the Prince of Peace, the Lion of Judah, King David, the Son of God. I know that I've been moved out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light, in the kingdom of grace. And one of the things that we can say today without any doubt, thank you, Lord, for the journey that we're on. We're not alone. You will never leave us nor forsake us. You will go with us even to the end of this age. And Lord, I pray a blessing over everyone. As they come to get prayer or as they go and leave, may your face shine upon them. Be gracious to them and let them know that they're in your hands eternally. The invisible and the visible all work together to accomplish your purpose. And we are created by you and for you. Let us enjoy your presence and your spirit. And we say amen to all these things. Amen and amen. God bless you. God bless you. Have an awesome, wonderful Christmas. Enjoy your family this afternoon. Enjoy. Don't eat too much. And see Jesus in the midst of all of the joys that you have. Merry Christmas.